In today's video, we will be looking at some of the worst video cards for gaming of recent years with offerings from both Nvidia and AMD. Our first examples will be from Nvidia's Kepler generation, beginning with the Nvidia GT710 GDDR3. Of course, criticizing office video cards and their gaming performance is pointless. However, the GT710 had variations with 1 or 2GB of GDDR5 memory, which was a way for Nvidia to get more sales from a cheap graphics card that couldn't do much regardless. This GDDR5 reset affected the price of the GT710, though today the card goes for around 20 to 40 bucks on popular sites like eBay, depending on the variant you choose, although it would just be easier to buy a CPU with an integrated graphics card like some of the Ryzen G series CPUs, and that would give you better performance than the GT710. But the GT730 is another matter. The version with 2GB of GDDR5 can somewhat run some games, which isn't as bad as the GT710 at its price range. However, the 4GB version was terrible. The 4GB of memory was impressive to have back in 2014, because even the flagship GTX 780 Ti had only 3GB. But there was a catch. The GT730 was running 4GB of GDDR3, which was outdated and slow, and that was then. In 2023, you can't play modern AAA titles on such a video card, and the 1GB GDDR5 version is enough for basic office tasks and display purposes, but in general, it would be a waste of money if bought as a gaming option. Back then, Nvidia wasn't the only ones making such GPUs. AMD took an equally active part in the circus with their Radeon R7 240, which came with 4GB of VRAM, and at first glance, everything looked fine. It had a modern PCIe Gen 3 interface, a full-size 128-bit memory bus. It was the perfect budget graphics card. But wait, it came with 4GB of GDDR3 memory. It did end up having a version with 2GB of GDDR5 to compete with the GT730, but the performance still left a lot to be desired, and it still lost against the GT730. However, there have been times when Nvidia really pushed their luck, as with the GTX 970. This was a card that Nvidia marketed as having 4GB of VRAM, but it only came with 3.5GB usable, since the remaining 500MB ran at a lower frequency. And if the VRAM usage exceeded the 3.5GB of fast memory available, you would end up losing performance. This became such a huge scandal that Nvidia ended up in a lawsuit that ended with a settlement of them having to refund $30 to their customers who had previously bought a GTX 970. Now moving to the Pascal generation, there was the release of the Nvidia GT 1030. Originally, it came with a 2GB GDDR5 version that was obviously not directed at gaming, but could actually run some older titles at 1080p low or medium. But there was a 2GB DDR4 version, which was a massive downgrade in performance, and it cost about the same as the GDDR5 version. However, the drama didn't end there. Nvidia released the GTX 1060, one with 6GB of GDDR5 and one with 3GB of GDDR5. Instead of it being just a reduction in VRAM, the 3GB version came with defective silicon and a 10% reduction in core count, from 1,280 cores on the 6GB version to 1,152 on the 3GB version. So, not only were you limited by the 3GB of VRAM, but you lost performance as well if you opted for the 3GB version, while the immediate competition from EMD, which was the RX 470 and 480, had versions of 4GB and 8GB instead. The next card is from Team Red, with their Radeon RX 5500 XT. In fact, this was the first sign of a rather bad trend. At first look, everything seems to be fine. According to the specs, you get 4 or 8GB of GDDR6 memory, a 128-bit memory bus, and a modern PCIe Gen 4 interface. But of course, there was a catch. It was running PCIe Gen 4x8 instead of the usual x16, and this meant that anyone who didn't have a motherboard with PCIe Gen 4 support would be limited to 8 lanes rather than the usual 16 on Gen 3, and since PCIe Gen 3 is slower than Gen 4, this would obviously affect performance on gamers on older motherboards. Moving on to the Radeon RX 5700 XT, The video card itself was released as a direct competitor for the RTX 2070. However, the ASUS TUF Gaming X3 model had a serious overheating issue that would run the GPU well over the recommended temperature limit due to poor cooling on the memory, since ASUS used a very thin heat spreader and the temperatures would reach up to 105 degrees when the recommended operating temperature was 95 degrees. All this led to crashes, thermal throttling, and a huge drop in performance, which subsequently ruined the reputation of Team Red in light of the issue. The next card is the Radeon RX 6500 XT. This is where things became worse. It was a new generation budget card with GDDR6 memory, but it came with a 64-bit memory bus and PCIe Gen 4x4 with no video encoder support. It even lacked AV1 encoding or decoding, and running it on a PCIe Gen 3 motherboard would cause a massive drop in performance of up to 40%. Overall, it was a bad offering from AMD to gamers. And now, with current gen, Nvidia has failed to provide better budget options with the RTX 4000 series. The release of the RTX 4060 and the 4060 Ti was underwhelming. The cards came with 8GB on the 4060 and a 16GB option for the 4060 Ti. Both have a 128-bit memory bus and the PCIe Gen 4x8, which means, apart from the new DLSS frame generation technology supported only by the RTX 4000 series, you get no worthwhile performance upgrading from last-gen RTX 3060 and 3060 Ti. Not to mention, despite the price cuts made by Nvidia on the 8GB version of the RTX 4060 Ti models, the VRAM is barely enough to run future games without running into VRAM limitations. Well, it's probably worth mentioning the RTX 4090. Despite it being the only RTX 4000 series GPU with a decent price-to-performance ratio, it's also had some drama of its own with the new 12V high-power connector that was a fire hazard at the time of release. The issue still exists, but it's preventable if you always ensure the GPU's power adapter cable is properly plugged in, or use high-quality adapters or power supplies. The built-in 12V high-power connector, just to be on the safe side. Well, that's all for today. Thank you for watching. Give us your feedback in the comments on which GPUs should have made the list. Like the video and subscribe, and see you again at Live Games.